Hi there, my name is Jeremy Krug, and in this video we're going to be learning about the history of atomic discovery, or in other words, how we know what atoms are, what they are like. And in this video, we're going to talk about the contributions of several scientists and how they have helped us to understand about atoms over the course of history. If you're new to my channel, I'd like to encourage you to take a look around. This is the place for everything honors chemistry and AP chemistry. Take a look at the playlist, take a look at the videos, the lab demonstrations. I think you'll like what you see. And if you really like what you do see, then I do encourage you to subscribe. Now, as we take a look at this story of atomic discovery, we're actually going to start a long time ago, over 2,000 years ago, with a Greek philosopher named Democritus. Now, he lived well over 2,000 years ago, and you might recall that philosophers back then thought about the nature of being, the nature of the universe. And most philosophers back then thought that if you took a sample of matter and cut it in half, that you could take that sample and cut it in half and cut it in half and actually keep repeating that process forever. Well, Democritus was the first philosopher that we know of that actually said that if you took a piece of matter and cut it in half and then take that piece and cut it in half and cut it in half and cut that in half, eventually you'd get to a piece of matter that was so small that you could no longer cut it in half and still have that material. And he called that very tiny, indivisible piece of matter atomos. Now, atomos looks like our modern English word for atom, doesn't it? Now, atomos basically in Greek means indivisible. We give Democritus credit for giving us the first contemporary definition of the atom. And for all practical purposes, his definition is the same, essentially, as the definition that we use today. Today we say that an atom is the smallest particle of an element that retains the properties of that element. So we give Democritus credit for that very early definition of an atom that honestly still works today. Now, if we take a look at this pie right here, we can cut that pie in half and we have half a pie. We can cut that half in half again and have a quarter. If we keep repeating that, eventually after about 90 cuts, we're going to get to what is essentially an atom of that apple pie. And so we can think about atoms as a very, very tiny unit of material. Now, to be honest, we have to go forward a long, long time before we hear any other talk about atoms in the scientific world. Now, in fact, if we go forward to around the year 1774, we have a French scientist and tax collector, actually, named Antoine Lavoisier. Now, he performed chemistry as kind of a hobby, and as a tax collector, he had access to a lot of wealth, and he was able to commission some of the best balances and scales that had been built up to that point. Well, what Lavoisier did was he carried out lots of chemical reactions in his laboratory in his home, and he found that no matter what the chemical reaction was, if you burn something, if you oxidize it, it really doesn't matter. No matter what the chemical reaction is, the total mass of the products that you have at the end is going to be exactly equal to the total mass of the reactants that you have at the beginning of the reaction. Now, today we call that the law of conservation of mass. And this was an excellent idea that Lavoisier came up with. And honestly, we use that today. It is absolutely true that no matter what the reaction is, as long as you have any chemical reaction, the mass of the reactants is equal to the mass of the products that you have at the end. Now, if we move forward a few more years, we have another French chemist named Joseph Proust. And around the year 1794, Joseph Proust started studying chemical compounds. And he noticed that no matter what the chemical compound was, it was going to have a constant mass ratio of its elements. And so, for example, if you were to study water, it doesn't matter where this water comes from, whether it's from the Indian Ocean, a polar ice cap, a lake in your area, or the faucet in your home, that water is going to have 89% oxygen and 11% hydrogen. And that is the constant mass ratio of elements that you're going to find. Now, today we call that the law of definite proportions. And that's a good name because it tells us that the proportion or the percentage of any compound is going to be definite or constant, essentially. And so Joseph Proust studied all these different types of compounds, and he found that no matter the compound, it was that case for a compound. Now, he also discovered, as it turns out, that the sugar in honey was the same as the sugar in grapes, which was kind of a novel concept for people back then. And he carried out this same concept, that you could carry out the mass percent of these elements in the compounds and find out that that was the case. Now, if we move forward a few more years, we get to the British chemistry teacher, John Dalton. Here's his picture. Around the year 1803, he was able to take some of the concepts that other scientists had come up before him and explain those in terms of atoms. And so we give him credit for formulating the first atomic theory. Now notice, we're about to take a look at some concepts that Democritus mentioned, Lavoisier had demonstrated, and Joseph Proust had demonstrated as well in his atomic theory. So for example, you might remember that Democritus talked about these things called atoms. Well, Dalton said, all elements are composed of atoms. That was one of the parts of his atomic theory. We also find that Lavoisier talked about how mass cannot be created or destroyed in a chemical reaction. Well, we can explain that in terms of atoms. Dalton said that that was the case because all of these substances are made of atoms, and it's the atoms that are not being created or destroyed in a chemical reaction, that law of conservation of mass. Now, Dalton also said that all atoms of an element are identical to each other, but they are different from atoms of other elements. And he also took this idea from Joseph Proust and said that the reason that compounds have this constant mass ratio of elements is because they have a constant ratio of atoms of elements. So for example, in our example of water, two atoms of hydrogen and one atom of oxygen, H2O. And that's the formula for all water, no matter where it comes from, that law of definite proportions. So here we have the four parts of Dalton's atomic theory. Now, there was a part of that that we know today is not correct. This first part of his third statement, we know today that all atoms of an element are actually not identical to each other. We'll talk about that in an upcoming video in this unit. Now, if we move forward quite a bit more, about another 80 or so years, we have J.J. Thomson. Now, J.J. Thomson, somewhere around the year 1897, used cathode ray tubes to discover that there were very light, negatively charged particles that were found in all atoms. And so we give him credit for discovering electrons. And so he called these negatively charged particles electrons. We know that if you take a cathode ray tube and have some charged particles in there and put an electric plate on either side of that, that the negatively charged particles were deflected away from the negative pole and toward the positive pole or plate there. And so he called those electrons. Now, being the good scientist that he was, J.J. Thomson tried to explain or tried to describe what atoms looked like. And so he came up with what today we call the plum pudding model. That sounds kind of an unusual name for a model, but he surmised that an atom was essentially a mass of this positively charged material with these negatively charged electrons just kind of randomly floating around inside the atom. And so this is his image of what an atom looked like. You know, this positively charged mass, basically, with these negatively charged bubbles or electrons just kind of floating around in there. He said it was a plum pudding model because the electrons were randomly scattered, kind of like plums in plum pudding. Now, most of us don't eat plum pudding today, but maybe you've had a chocolate chip cookie, and it's kind of the same idea. Chocolate chips in chocolate chip cookies are essentially randomly scattered. That was his concept of the atom. Now, if we move forward a few more years, we have Robert Millikan and Harvey Fletcher. And around the year 1908, they performed an experiment called the oil drop experiment. Now, here's a picture of the apparatus that they used. We have a drum here, as you can see. And they took a little bulb, this little bulb here, and they actually would squeeze that and charge up tiny droplets of oil using electricity and friction. And based upon that, they were actually able to use an electric field to measure the charge of a single electron. That's quite amazing for well over 100 years ago. They found that the charge of a single electron was 1.592 times 10 to the negative 19th coulombs. So quite an amazing experiment for 1908, the oil drop experiment, finding the charge of a single electron. Now, if we move forward to our next experiment and our next scientist, we have Ernest Rutherford. Now, around 1911, Ernest Rutherford performed an experiment that today we call the gold foil experiment. Now, what he did was he shot very dense, positively charged alpha particles at very thin gold foil. Now, in case you don't know what alpha particles are, like we say here, they're very dense and they're positively charged. Now, he shot these alpha particles at very, very thin gold foil. Now, his idea was that if the plum pudding model was correct, all of these alpha particles should go straight through that gold foil. Now, he found that most of the time, the alpha particles did go straight through the gold foil. However, every so often, every couple thousand of his alpha particles was actually deflected by the gold foil. In fact, every now and then he found that some of his alpha particles ricocheted right off of the gold foil. Now, this was very unusual. He wasn't expecting this at all. In fact, he said, this is like if you take a cannonball and shoot it at a piece of tissue paper and that cannonball bounces off of the tissue paper. That's not supposed to happen. Now, the only way that these alpha particles could have bounced off of something in those little tiny gold atoms is that if something inside those gold atoms was also very positively charged and very dense. So he had these alpha particles that were positively charged and dense, and they had to be, bouncing off of something else like that. And so he said that inside these gold atoms, in fact, inside all atoms, there is a dense positively charged mass. And he called that the nucleus. So a very good, ingenious experiment that he designed over 100 years ago once again. Now, he called those positive charges protons. And so notice our model, our understanding of the atom is getting more advanced all the time. We have electrons. Now we have a nucleus where there are protons inside that nucleus. If we move forward a few more years to around the year 1917, we have the Danish physicist Niels Bohr. And Niels Bohr did experiments and showed that electrons are not randomly scattered at all. In fact, he said that they're found in energy levels, and he said that they orbit around the nucleus. And so maybe you've seen this picture or a picture like this, the Bohr model of the atom. Back then, a lot of people like Niels Bohr thought that electrons actually orbited the nucleus in these circular orbits, kind of like the way that planets orbit the sun. Some people thought that every atom was like a little teeny tiny solar system. Well, today we know that that's not really the case. There are energy levels, but there aren't these circular orbits like we see here. There are energy levels, but they look a little different from this. We know also that electrons can jump from one energy level to another. In fact, Niels Bohr talked about this, but they're not able to hover in between energy levels. And so he called this a quantum function, that electrons could be in one energy level, they could be in another, they could jump from one to another, but they can't hover in between the two. Now, if we think about the concept of atoms and the concept of the nucleus from, say, about 100 years ago, it's interesting that there wasn't a whole lot said in chemistry textbooks. I like to collect old chemistry textbooks myself, and here's a textbook I have. It's called Fundamentals of Chemistry, published in 1924. So we're talking about over 100 years ago. And notice what it says about the nucleus. This is all that that book says about the nucleus. It says, little is known about the nucleus beyond the fact that it is electrically positive and is the more stable part of the atom, which gives weight. In the smaller atoms, it is smaller than the electron, but has practically all of the weight of the atom and thus is extremely dense. Two sentences. And that's all that this textbook says about the nucleus. How far we have progressed over the last century, haven't we? Now, as we finish up our story of the atom, we have one more scientist to talk about, and that's James Chadwick. And around the year 1932, he discovered that there was some more mass in the nucleus of the atom along with the protons. And these other particles did not have any charge to them. And so he called them neutrons because they are neutral, as in like they don't have a charge. And he said, you know, these neutrons don't have a charge. They have about the same mass as protons. They're a little bit heavier than protons, ever so slightly, but they have approximately the same mass as protons. And so as we get to the end of our story regarding the history of atomic discovery, we can see how much we have progressed in our modern society. We started over 2,000 years ago with not really a concept of atoms. And then we started to talk about how mass is conserved in any chemical reaction. And then there are these things called atoms. And what are they like? Even to the point where we can discover individual parts, subatomic particles. I hope you learned something from this video. Hope you enjoyed it. If you did, please smash that like button. I hope to see you again on my channel. Thanks for watching. I'll see you soon.